can have all the stuff in the world, but if it doesn't sell, if you haven't been in a thrift store, go ahead and pop in, because everybody that comes in, we have great comments. Because of Jeannie, it's her fault. The place is organized like a retail store. We have lots and lots of stuff in there. And it's all in its place. It's all organized completely. We have other volunteers. Paula used to come in. I don't know what happened to that, but she used to come in and help display and market. And we have some other volunteers. We're waiting to get over some health issues. But come on in and check us out. You'll be impressed. It's not your usual thrift store. It's a step up. No doubt about it. We're still working on looking at getting built up behind the thrift store for our events and things like this, because sometimes we don't have a stage here. I don't know if you noticed, but it's okay. My plan was to have it done about 2.5 years ago, but I really like to shoot for getting in there by New Year's. Maybe we could actually have a cookout or something on New Year's Day or New Year's Eve. Never know what could happen. So keep that in your prayers and thoughts. Trying to think what other kind of concerns we have here. I think we're doing good. We're on track. We're studying the book of Matthew. And Bob's been doing a great job, as usual. I don't know if Pastor Bill is going to be in visiting today or not, but let's get up and I'm going to say a little word of prayer. We'll get started. We got to overpower the little running event over there, but we're not going to overpower them. We're going to enhance them. We'll be the musical enhancement. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come out here and worship. We thank you for the freedom in the country that we still have. Thank God we can still come out and mention God, mention Jesus. There's other countries around the world where people are dying for that privilege, unfortunately. But here we still have that freedom. Thank you. And we thank you for the Spirit of Christ that you laid within us. The way Jesus said that the Spirit would live in us and guide us. So, Father, it's our strongest message every week that we would accept that Spirit in us, listen to it, and walk in righteousness as you would have us to do. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So come on up, kids, and do some singing with me. If you have a singing voice and you're interested in being a part of this, we could use a good singing voice. If you have a bad singing voice, you can come up and move your lips and we'll turn your mic off. Hey, it's been done before.
Intro in one bar.
Life is like a mountain railway with an engineer so brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curves, the hills, the tunnels, never fall, never fail. Keep your hands upon the throttle and your eyes upon the rail. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in thy praise forevermore. Life is like a mountain railway with an engineer so brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curves, the hills and tunnels, never fall, to never fail. And keep your hands upon the throttle and your eyes upon the rail. As you roll across the trestle, spanning Jordan's swelling tide, you behold the Union Depot into which your train will glide. There you'll meet the superintendent, God the Father, God thy Son.
that yard. Each joy is greeted. Weary pilgrim, welcome home. Life is Savior, thou wilt guide us.
Sorry.
Till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in God's grace forevermore. Life is like that mountain railway with an engineer so brave. We must make that run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curves, the hills and tunnels, never fall to never fail. And keep your hands upon the throttle, and your eyes upon the rail. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us, till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in God's grace forevermore. Where the angels wait to join us in God's grace forevermore.
Cha cha cha.
Do what?
Here's an old German tune. I call it German because it feels like opening eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
still sun there. You want the umbrella?
might be nice.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like the flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here, will be forever mine. Will be.
All right, good job, kids. Turn off the effects, please. Yank the effects down.
Yeah.
So our band has been a little reprieved because I was out of the country for a few weeks. My bass player, Trevor, was out of the country. Hey, there, let's sing a song.
I'm sorry. All right. Sorry about that one.
No worries. Me nasty, he said. So, and Trevor was out of the country for like 5 weeks, and then our drummer Tom went up to Michigan for his daughter's wedding, and he came back with some kind of stuff in his chest. And then our keyboard player had surgery that was supposed to be minor and turned into major. So the reason I'm saying that is because our band Therapy is playing next Saturday at the Farmer's Market from 8:30 till noon. And we could use your prayers because we have a stand-in keyboard player we're going to rehearse with Tuesday. But if you want to see how we pull it off, we'll be at the Farmer's Market next Saturday morning, 8:30 till noon, with our band called Therapy. And I just found out yesterday there's somebody plagiarizing our name called Group Therapy, so I got to have a visit with that guy. I don't know who it is, but we don't worry about it. There is no competition. We just enhance each other. So, Pastor Bob, if you want to come up and jump into your teaching in the book of Matthew, chapter 5, I know that they would appreciate it. And by the way, I ordered some of my first book, Just Trust. Bob, how many think we put through the recovery stations? Maybe 300 or 400 of them?
Well, a lot of them.
A lot of them. And if you haven't read it and you're struggling with how do I step through this and believe, grab one of my books. I think I might have one more in the van. I ordered like 20 more, and then we're going to order a bunch more. But as we get involved in another recovery center, we'll buy another batch for them as well.
That is a really good book. I've had so many clients, people that I've offered the book to, or we've given it to in the recovery centers, come back and tell me, wow, you know, people that were gone through Alpha, but they were struggling with their spirituality, and they said, that book really helped me. It helped clear things up because it's written with the beautiful simplicity of the gospel. So good morning. Here we are in October and a nice early fall day for Florida. I'm very jealous. A friend of mine was telling me he and his wife took a ride up in the foothills of the Smokies the other day, and the leaves are all changing colors. They saw like 19 deer, including 2 big bucks. And they also saw a black bear. And I'm like, man, to be able to just leave your house and go into that. We have a lot of beauty here, but that is a different kind of beauty up there. And I have to admit to being jealous. So we are in Matthew chapter 5. And at this point, we get to, you know, we had like last week we had Jesus's drop the mic moment. You know, he appeared on the scene earlier with John the Baptist. He basically acknowledged John's ministry, and Jesus picked up from there. And then he had his wilderness experience, and then he went into the temple, and he announced that the prophecy in Isaiah and so much other prophecy in the Old Testament was being fulfilled right in front of them in the person of Jesus Christ. And his ministry begins, and it's already begun because he's been out healing and the crowds have been following him. What we left out last week was how quickly that the religious people turned on Jesus. You know, we left out that when he left the temple, they were actually already mad enough to kill him at that point because the religious authorities were already feeling threatened. They'd been feeling threatened for some time with John the Baptist out there violating all the social norms. And how quickly we allow social norms, which have their place, but how quickly we allow social norms and customs and all of that to become like our own form of religious law. And if somebody doesn't meet the picture of what we think a good Christian, even that term, good Christian, that shows a very shallow understanding of what it means to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, because it's speaking to the lack of knowledge of the identity that we receive in Christ and where our worth comes from. But we're so entrenched in this idea of our worthiness is all based on externals, the approval of our neighbors, of our friends, of people at large, co-workers, bosses and employers, employees, the pop culture image of what you're supposed to wear and what you're supposed to sound like and how cool you're supposed to be. We get so wrapped up in that the church is not immune from this. It's just as entrenched in the church as it is outside the church. Go to any large church and see. Walk in there dressed different than that particular church tends to dress. And see how, you know, how you feel. See what the vibe is.
Yeah, come here with shoes on.
You have it. Yeah. So, I still love the story of the pastor that went in there dressed like a quote-unquote bum. Well, he went in there dressed like a person living on the street that doesn't have access to, you know, as many showers and as many washings of clothes. He went in there dressed like a homeless person, and they were shocked when halfway through whatever service they're having, he walked up to the podium and started preaching. And it was their pastor that they had been, try not to look. Don't want them putting the hand over this way. They might ask me for money. Oh, my gosh. So the religious authorities have already decided that they're going to have a problem with Jesus. And maybe that's the reason that Jesus' first actual recorded sermon is not in the temple. We know he had taught in the temple, but his actual recorded first sermon for history in the Bible is on the side of the mountain, outside. And when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. He opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." And that's what we know as the Beatitudes. And yet, this is just the very opening paragraph of what probably occurred, a sermon that was given, a teaching, over 2 or 3 days on the side of that mountain. You might say this was the Woodstock of early Christianity. because it wasn't within the social norms. They were used to going to the temple. They were used to listening to the priests. They were used to being told the law. They were used to be having the sacrifices required of them. You got to understand, this wasn't like another Sunday the way we do church. This was something radically different, and it was being taught by someone who was radically different. And maybe these words are important enough that we need to break them down a little bit. We need to get to the crux of, as best we can, what is Jesus really saying when he's just saying that these are the kind of people that are blessed. Now, my old religious ears heard this is the way you need to be so you can go get the blessing. But Jesus doesn't use that tense. He uses present tense. These are those that are blessed. And why are they blessed? Maybe we need to look at that for a little bit. So let's start with the first one. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. First of all, we know that Jesus taught that the kingdom of heaven is now. That the kingdom of heaven is here. That the kingdom of heaven is present within you. He said the kingdom is within you. And Western Christianity has missed this largely for at least 500 years. For at least 500 years. If you go back and study some of the Christian mystics going back to the, and when I use the word mystic, don't think it's all New Agey. The Christian mystics are the ones that learned to really follow what God said, to be still and know that He is God. And they learned what Jesus taught about stillness. And they learned to follow the example of Jesus in stepping away from the drama, from the crowds, from the entertainment, from the strife of daily life, and from the strife of this overactive mind that's always thinking, thinking, thinking. That's the hard part. So the early mothers, what they call the desert mothers and fathers, in about the 3rd century, Christianity had gotten very popular, but it was becoming very cosmopolitan, right? It was becoming very contemporary, very cosmopolitan. You had the marriage of the church and the state. It was becoming very conventional. And they sought the pure essence of spirituality in relationship with God without all the religious trappings that were beginning to be added. And they went out into the desert in the Middle East, in Egypt, in Arabia, in Syria, in that area where Christianity had spread out from Jerusalem. And they went out into the desert and they spent time alone from God, and they formed the beginnings, the genesis of the monastic communities. And then through the centuries, you can read many of what were later called saints, from St. Francis, St. Augustine, so many of these others talked about contemplation, becoming still, becoming quiet, meditation as the other side of the coin of spoken prayer. And then you can see all the way up into about the 15th or 16th century, Julian of Norwich, St. John of the Cross, Teresa of, however you pronounce it, Avila, they wrote about meditation and becoming still, listening. And we talk about that in Alpha Listening, but there's a stage beyond that. See, early religion begins with, now I'm talking at God. Talk, talk, talk. Oh, I need to pray to God about this. I need to pray to God about that. I need to get covered for these people and those people, me, all these situations. It can become very obsessive compulsive. Pray, pray, pray. Talk, talk, talk. Now imagine if you did that to a friend, or maybe you know somebody like that. They come up and they just chat, 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 talk, 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 see, you got to go. They don't want to care what you have to say. The conversation goes right back to them. And then it's got to go. But isn't that how most of us pray? If you get honest, do we listen? See, there's talking at God, and then we learn to talk with God, and maybe we actually start to learn to listen. But spiritual maturity is about learning to be with God. Be with God. And having a contemplative practice, not as a checklist of I just should do this, but actually I'm going to sit for 20 minutes a day, and I'm going to just listen. I'm just going to be. I'm just going to focus on a word linked to my breath, get still, let the mental chatter dissipate. It's going to come back. You let it go, it's going to come back. You let it go, it's going to come back. You let it go. You return to that sacred word, or you return to your breath, and you just be with God, and you start to get those little glimpses, those little moments, even micro moments at first, where you sense the silence, capital S, the stillness, the solitude, and spending that 20 minutes a day, somehow something changes in the rest of your day. You can go back to your breath. You can ground yourself. You start to sense God. You start to being less reactive. It's a process. It's a discipline. It takes time. It takes effort. But it's something you allow to happen. You don't make happen so much. And that is a part of spiritual life that I never learned in church. I never learned that in church. Maybe a little nod to a verse or two about it, but nobody teaches that. Or do they? They do, actually. They teach it in a number of denominations and outside of denominations. But it's not a part of mainstream Western Orthodox Christianity yet, in the sense of being practiced everywhere. But people are catching on, and they're going back to what was lost for the last 500 years, that part of being still. And that's going to fit in with everything we do in life, because this is an example that Jesus gave us. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, who are the poor in spirit? They're people that know they don't have it all figured out. They're not self-righteous. They're not so filled with religiosity that they can't learn. In other words, it's similar to what the Buddhists would say, having a beginner's mind. We need a beginner's mind in Christianity. We are so caught up in learning methods and techniques and reading the next self-improvement book that we never get to the point of what this in the 12 steps. We could go to step one and realize that we're powerless. Everyone here that Jesus talked about being blessed are people that are powerless and know it. You see, we're all powerless. We just don't know it. See, we're trying to struggle with our power. It's a control thing. We're on this power trip. We know we're uncomfortable, but we got to keep running to distract ourselves from how realizing how little power we have. And yet, Jesus lays out a path of powerlessness, of brokenness. Blessed are the poor in spirit, those that know they don't all have it all figured out. In Matthew 19, the account's given and starting in verse 13, of Jesus blessing the children. Then some children were brought to him so that he might lay his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked them. We're too self-important to have you bringing these little kids up here. Who has time for kids? This is like really important religious stuff. But Jesus said, let the children alone and do not hinder them from coming to me, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. After laying his hands on them, he departed from there. Jesus made time for the little ones, the innocent ones, those that didn't think they have it all figured out, but they just naturally were drawn to Jesus. It was the spiritually arrogant that didn't like Jesus. They couldn't admit their powerlessness. In fact, they were threatened by what they perceived him to be, because they were thinking with the flesh. Obviously, this guy's charismatic. People are following him. He must be powerful, so he must want our spot. No, he didn't want their spot. He wanted them. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Grief can be so high and so thick and so deep that it seems insurmountable. But Jesus promises to comfort those that are grieving. And honestly, in counseling, you get to a point, Dave will attest to this, that it's hard to know how to comfort people apart from offering them the one who can actually comfort them? Right? I mean, we're called to be there, all of us, sometimes just to be with people. It's not so much talking to them and certainly not talking at them and offering little cliches that only invalidate their feelings, but to be with them and allow Christ to comfort them directly and through us. And your presence speaks volumes. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, you look at modern secular society, who we tend to worship, it isn't the gentle. We tend to idolize the powerful, the strong, the mighty, right? We want powerful leaders that can set things straight and give them the what for. And we idolize this. We idolize, unfortunately, when people put down other people, when they get ugly and rude. And we idolize that because it shows how powerful they are. And yet, that's not who Jesus is calling blessed. Because again, it's an illusion of power. People, we're so used to comparing ourselves to others. And then people will insult what other people do, what they wear, how they look, how they act. And it's all a big cover-up. See, we're still naked in the garden. We feel like we got to cover up. So at least let's cover up by distracting. Let's point at how somebody else is deficient so you can't see my deficiencies. Human behavior, this is the flesh. And Jesus is turning the whole way the world looks at things upside down. Because he's not calling the powerful, the put-downers, the violent, the aggressive, the ones that tend to be, you know, the ones that we tend to watch, whether it's on sports or in the movies or pop culture, what we tend to worship as a society. It's nothing like that. It's nothing like they were used to then, because, listen, in the society at that time, they didn't have many rights at all. You had the right to go work and give about 2/3 of your income between temple taxes and Roman taxes, and you had to live on the rest. And we're headed that way today, unfortunately, seems like. But that's the way it was, and there was no social safety net. And people, they hate it. It's a love-hate relationship. They hate the powerful, but they love the powerful because they wish they could be powerful like that. A friend of mine was talking about his faith. He changed careers in midlife. He said as he sent off his application to go to seminary, as he had his hands on it, as he started to put it into the post office drop box, he said, "This changes everything." And he submitted it, and he became a deacon in the Catholic Church. And he said, if I don't have my faith, Jesus isn't real. He said, I might as well be a warlord. Really, warlord, yeah. Take the women I want. Take the material things I want. Get what I can get. If there is no God, what else is there? Now, that explains why the world is the way that it is, because most people aren't believing in God. And truthfully, I'm not talking about the thin minority that are vocal atheists. I'm including people that go to church, but it's just a thin veneer of lip service because we're depending on ourselves and we're worshiping the powerful. Who are you depending on? Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. He didn't say blessed are the self-righteous. He didn't even say blessed are the righteous. He said blessed are those who hunger and thirst. They have a drive for Jesus. They want the relationship. Their soul has this deep longing. That's the problem in our country, I'm afraid. We are so spoiled. I've said it before, and I love America. I love the ideals, not of pop culture, but of what we've professed we stand for. We certainly have not always lived up to it. People are afraid of that. Oh no. See, we have this Western all or nothing thinking. You either worship your country and it's all right and everything we've done in history is all good, or you're not a patriot or something. I don't know. What would Jesus say? Israel's history, we learn, as far as we went in the New Testament, wasn't all that squeaky clean. Do you think that any other country is going to do much better? Have we done much better? If you are a poor, I don't know, if you're in a poor third world country, pick any country you like, and you're living in your little ramshackle, we would call it a shack, they would call it a house, and you're watching on the TV with the three channels you get, and you see American culture coming out of the screen at you every day, what would you think about America? I'm not talking about watching the news and hearing what the left says or the right says. I'm talking about if you just scroll through, what's important to Americans? What's important to most of the world? Getting ahead. Money. Money so I can have the creature comforts I want. And yet the creature comforts we have are so much more than what much of the world experiences. And as Dave mentioned earlier, we are blessed that we can come here and not just mention God, but proclaim God and Jesus Christ. But you take a walk around our cities, are people safe? Do you feel safe walking through your town after 9 a.m. or 9 p.m. at night? There's a lot of issues out there. And the world's not focusing on God. The world's focusing on what idol can I put in office to fix things? I need somebody powerful. I need somebody powerful to step in and fix all this. The only thing we can fix is ourselves, and we can't do that on our own. We can't do that on our own. Jesus is showing us a blueprint that is upside down from the world's way of thinking, and he says again and again, for those that have ears to hear, listen, for those that have eyes to see, understand. It takes God to open our eyes and open our ears. This is why we need quiet time alone with God. We need to learn to yield. It's not that we're not necessarily saved, but we stay on the superficial level with our faith. And Jesus is inviting us to go deeper. Spend time. Be transformed. He didn't say transform yourself. He said be transformed. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. You hear a lot of talk out there in the world and in this country, you know, about holding people accountable. And then we want the worst to happen, that those that make mistakes, because they got to pay for it. But where's the mercy? We don't know how to be merciful. The law can only condemn. I went before a judge trying to get this guy into safe harbor. He was bound for jail, said he wanted to get off drugs, wanted to change his life. We were willing to give him the opportunity. Didn't necessarily believe that he wanted to, but we were going to give him the opportunity, but the judge wouldn't. The judge listened to my whole spiel on the Journey to Freedom program, I explained to them about the introduction phase, the orientation, the regeneration phase, the whole program. I thought I laid it out beautifully. And he looked at me when I was done, and he said, the criminal justice system is about punishment, not rehabilitation. And he sentenced the guy to prison. That's the mindset. You pay, and there's a place for law, but in our own lives, are we offering mercy, or are we just holding people accountable? Let me hold everything you've done wrong. Let me bring it up later to you. Let me keep a list mentally, if not actually written down, and let me weigh it out. Some people are passive aggressive. That's one I particularly detest myself. I'm sure I have other faults that are equally or worse, but passive aggressive. That's where you just clam up, put out the bad vibe, but don't say anything. Let them guess. I experienced it, honestly, as a kid when I was skipping school. I knew something was wrong for 2 or 3 days, but I didn't know what. I didn't know that they were on to me. They didn't say anything. And then it came out at an inopportune moment. Any moment would have been inopportune. But even as a kid, I'm like, what the heck? Why not just tell me you're busted and give me the punishment? Don't do this psychological torture where I'm wandering and walking on pins and needles. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. We can use some more peacemaking in the world, but even in our own lives, in families, there's what you call triangulation that happens, because it's family systems theory. It's just a form of dysfunction whereby you want person A to do what you want or buy into your agenda, so you go to person C, you being person B, you don't talk directly to them, you go get somebody else to talk to them. It's triangulation, right? It's a subtle form of manipulation. That's not peacemaking. We need more peacemaking. We need less drama. In Hebrews, the author writes in chapter 12, verse 14, pursue peace with all men and the sanctification without which no one will see the Lord. Pursue peace. See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many be defiled. Gosh, I was just reading of a road rage situation where two children were shot as these idiots shot at each other. One of them, I guess, was pulling up too close to the other, or one was braking, you know, pushing on the brakes and making them slow down behind them. One pulls up beside him. One of them whips out a gun, fires one shot, hits a five-year-old. The other one sprays the other down with bullets, and I think an 11 or 12-year-old was shot. I think they both lived. Well, what are we doing in this country? What are we doing? Peacemaking. Do we even know how? Do we even know what it means? Don't watch too much news, because I don't want you to get a real negative mindset. I try not to have a real negative mindset. And my wife will tell you I'm a geopolitical junkie. So I have to, you know, it's like withdraw not watching the news. But I've seen how toxic it is, especially in older people. And I only because older people that are retired have time. And they sit on the TV all day watching the news. And you get, I don't care if you're on the left or the right, you're getting a very distorted picture of the world. Very distorted. I can turn on a news source aligned with my political beliefs, and I can watch it for an hour, and I'm going to feel more anxious and more depressed when I'm done. Not better, and I can watch your news channel, whatever it may be, and I guarantee you I'll lay a $100 bill down. It'll be the same way if you're watching the regular media. Now, there are some alternatives. On the internet, there's the Good News Network, and instead of all the drama popping up on your screen, positive things that are actually happening, good stories that don't get into the regular media, at least not very much. Be careful what you allow in your mind, because everybody's got an agenda, and they're spending multi-billions of dollars through advertising and other ways to get you converted over so you'll buy, or if it's not an outlay of cash to buy something, that you'll buy in to whatever it is they're selling. I prefer to buy in to what a guy sitting on the side of a mountain 2,000 years ago said. It makes more sense when you let it soak into your spirit and you realize how liberating it is. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. Salt of the earth. We're probably never going to be in our lifetimes the majority as believers, as followers of Jesus Christ. If you truly are going to follow Jesus Christ and have him as the grounding of your being and the centerpiece of your life, that relationship, we're probably never going to be the majority. That's why he says salt. That's why he uses words like yeast, leavens the whole loaf. It changes the impact. The whole world is affected by it in a very positive way, even though we don't always see it at the time. He goes on, you are the light of the world. The light. Think of a beacon of light. Think of a lighthouse. What does that represent? Hope that you're going to make it through the storm and get there. Safety, security, hunger and thirst ties in together. We have a hunger and a thirst for security and for significance, to be safe, to be held by the living God that made us, to have a purpose that he gives us. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Do not think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter of stroke or stroke shall pass from the law until all is accomplished. I used to miss that part. I'm like, man, this is confusing. He's saying that we're still under the law? No, he's saying that until all is accomplished, the law was in effect. On the cross, he said, it is finished. He fulfilled the law. We receive his righteousness. It isn't based on our behavior. We don't earn it. We receive it. So there's no place for self-righteousness, because we don't have self-righteousness. We have Christ righteousness, and that is the good news of the gospel. And when we understand that, it's like, and when it sinks in, I don't have to compare myself. I don't have to be as good as somebody else doing something, or looking as good as somebody else looking like something, or having what somebody else has, because I have what's important and you have what's important. You have the righteousness of Christ living in you. You have that righteousness imputed to you. And as we learn to sit in silence, we become ever more mindful that we have His living presence abiding in us.
Did everybody get that?
Got it.
Okay, I'm just checking. Because there was a lot there. And I don't know how many times we said the word be. His being, we have our being in Him, that we can learn to be with God. We're human beings. And we get tied up with being human doings and human makings. Human beings having compassion for people when they hurt. I don't know if you ever been in a place of hurting and run across people who had no compassion and what that felt like for you. And then being in a place of hurting and meeting people who had complete compassion and empathy and understanding that were willing and able to help you. Those things change lives. Those people are the salt, the light, the preservers of life, those who give. The Sermon on the Mount has always been big in my life and my faith, but I didn't have much faith in the beginning, and I was running wild too. Had a lot of rage, had a lot of hatred, I had a lot of strife, had a lot of griping and complaining. And I'm glad Jesus didn't say things like that. Blessed are the name callers. Blessed are the judgers and the greedy. Blessed are the angry and the vicious and depressed. But you know what? After I discovered who God truly was, even though I was all those things, I have found that I'm blessed. I wasn't blessed in the middle of that. I was blessed by something outside of me. And I didn't realize I had a hunger and a thirst. You can't help when you don't have enough of food or water or security or significance. You can't help but be hungry. You don't have a choice. Our problem is how we try and figure it out on our own. Or pretend it isn't so, or mask it, or fog it. That was my journey. I don't want to admit that I hated life and hated myself and hated others. And it took a journey. It was a really hard one. So let's start up at the top here. And I always used to get really upset with somebody who say, well, he's a good Christian man. Well, what's a bad Christian look like? I mean, and isn't that a judgment? Well, you know, that Chris, he's a really good guy. And what about everybody around him? Isn't that kind of a judgment as well? I've learned to kind of be aware of some things in a different realm. Being an encourager of children instead of a fear monger. Careful, you're going to fall and break your head open. You know, I was always that guy, you know, stepping in, I'm going to save somebody. And I'm not the savior. It just took the longest time. And it took the longest time for me to figure out that I can't change anything really out there. I can only look at from the skin in. And even then, I need help with that, especially. So let's go back up to your blanks on your sheet. Jesus declares those living under God's reign. He says to them, make room for God rather than relying on yourselves. I got to thinking about when Bob was talking about going into meditation in a contemplative mode. And I'm wondering if there is some kind of an evolution of faith, because this is how kind of it went for me. I was learning how to, first I heard from God. That was my saving grace. I heard a voice that said, if you want my help, all you have to do is ask. I had a hard time believing it was true at first because my life was in such a shambles at the time. But I heard it twice in one night. If you want my help, all you have to do is ask. And I rested that night for the first time in 3 months. I got rest and sleep that night. I didn't know why or how. But then I saw things starting to line up, and for the first 2 hours of the next day, I met 3 different people that actually cared enough to listen to my tale, pray for me, pray with me, and tell me truth. It happened kind of just like that. and I needed it. And then I learned how to speak to God. This was my first step in the revolution. Speak to God, pray to God, ask God for help, ask Him for this, ask Him for that, ask Him for this. And the problem with that was I got angry when the vending machine God didn't spit out what I needed. I prayed and you didn't listen, so Then I learned to speak with God, which means a conversation, listening for. And that was part of a message, and I still do it. If you're praying for 5 minutes, listen for 10. I hated when my dad used to tell me it as a kid because I was a super rambunctious speed freak of a kid. And he would say, stop running your mouth. You got two ears and one mouth. You should be listening twice as much as you talk. I hated hearing it, but now it's become part of my mantra. If I can hear from God, His spoken word, and I start to understand His written word, and they line up, I'm in a pretty safe zone. So listen for God became next. Then became listen to God. Listening for Him's good. Yeah, I heard you. But I'm going to do it my way. Listen to God. Trust God. And then it came down to be with. 24/7. Oftentimes I've mentioned to people in counseling, where is God right now? And, well, God is everywhere, so God is here and God is there. Well, Jesus said He put His Spirit in you to lead you and guide you. God is here. And I'm learning to live like that. Because out there is a mess. So live with God. Abide in Him. That's where I'm getting to. When that happens, we don't strive to do these next things. They happen because God is leading. This next blank says, promote peace rather than strife and hatred. Those things will happen because a righteous God isn't going to lead you to righteousness. He's going to lead you to righteousness. Offer kindness and compassion instead of a harsh criticism. Sarcasm. What a concept. Bob mentioned probably over a year ago a book that he was reading called A Complaint-Free Life. Are you griping about everything that happens? Are you griping about the people in front of you who don't drive the way you're supposed to? That leads to strife. Complaint life leads to strife. Stress. I got enough stress in my life just with what's right here, the stuff I can see in the mirror. It's no good. God works through believers. You allow Him to be the kindness, Him to be the promoter of peace, Him to be the compassion. Because trying to do it won't get it done. Trying real hard to sit in a chair without actually sitting in the chair will never get you sat down in a chair. You got to do it. Trusting Him to do it is the key. He said, the few bring hope to the many. I am blessed to be working in the thrift store so many times when somebody comes in and you just can say a word or two that brightens their day. Tell them what a great smile they have. Sometimes people come in and you say a kind word and they just get this, you can feel this heaviness over them. And it saddens me, really. But you know what? I'm a jovial guy. Hey, how you doing?
Not a word.
Not a word. Silence. Oh, it can't be that bad. It's so good, you're speechless? And then they look at you even more angry sometimes. Just saying. The minority changes the course of history. I think Bob and I had this conversation just a few weeks ago that there's a bunch of us who are believing that God lives in us, God lives through us, that we can trust Him, we walk in faith. We're the remnant that He spoke about. There's a remnant of people here that are the salt of the earth and the light of the earth. I remember Mike Warnke saying, you know, if you're a Christian, you got to have that look on your face like you just ate a green persimmon and don't talk to me. I'm walking in the way. Yeah, you are in the way. Get out of the way so we can see Jesus. I thought it was a great analogy because that's what I saw in church most of my life. Christ's Spirit living in me can't be hidden. And it will impact others in the ways that I might have never know. When His Spirit comes through, people know. Other believers will feel it. I've felt it with other people. I've bumped into people in the grocery store and just have this, hey, you're a believer, aren't you? Yeah, how'd you know? I can just tell. There's a connection. We're a family. Jesus fulfilled the law. Well, what does that mean? He is fulfilling the law through you. Because He lives in you, and you begin to trust Him, you're not going to lie. You're not going to cheat. You're not going to steal. You're not going to do it. You're going to love others. You're going to have compassion. In receiving Him, I received His righteousness. I don't have to strive and try to be perfect. I'm far from it, and I always will be until this body's in the ground. We're perfected when we go into heaven. So I was thinking in the middle of this, it ought to be a new Olympic event, Bob. We have an event for compassion, an event for kindness, an event for peacemakers, and maybe somehow we could idolize those people. Not that there's an award, but there's a reward. There is a reward. I got the greatest retirement plan in the world when this body goes in the ground. It's a great retirement plan. I don't know exactly what it's going to be, but it's going to be so much better than here. And I'm good with it. I'm ready at any moment. Don't speed it along. I don't need your help. But I'm ready to go at any moment. And I hope you can find that in your life, that you're okay with when it comes close to the end of life. Because I see a lot of people panicking that. And I'm blessed to be able to have some counsel with them sometimes and say, are you prepared for this? What do you think it's going to be like? Why are you afraid? It's just a thought. Well, I've been a good Christian man all my life. Well, how do you know? Well, I went to church almost every week. I never said a foul word. I had a friend of mine did that most of their life. All their life, actually, now that I think about it. She never said a foul word. She didn't go to church, but she never said a foul word. She never drank alcohol. Every time, even if you abused her, she would come back to you in love. She was friendly with mean people. That was my dog. Even a dog can do that. But where is your peace? Where is your heart? Where's your joy? Are you resting assured? And if not, the only way to fix it, like Bob said, we get frustrated sometimes when we're dealing with grieving people. I can't help. I can be there. But the best way is to offer the one who can comfort. In the meantime, just be. And I always hated John Glenn for when he gave me this stupid answer, but it was the smartest answer in the world. What's God telling you? Huh? What's God telling me? I never thought of that. Well, if He loves you and He's good all the time and He wants what's best for you, it'd be a good idea to listen to Him, wouldn't it? Well, what did you think you needed that God hasn't already given you? That was another one I didn't like hearing. You're kind of arrogant. No, He was true. So that's when you start being contemplative, and you start going, huh, what is really going on in here? What is really going on in here? And who can fix it if I can't? What is wrong with you? I don't know. But if God built me, I'm going to trust Him to fix me. And that's where I stand. If you drive a Ford and it's broke down, don't pull into a Toyota dealer. They're going to look at you and say, oh, we don't work on those. If God built you, I think He can be the one who fixed you. Father, as we close up this service, we got two more songs. One of them's requested by Miss Wendy back there. But God, it is always our biggest desire. I know in Bob's heart, I know in Bill's heart, I know in my heart that people will find faith. that they learn that God is good, that they can learn to listen to, listen for, spend time with, and have a relationship with a God who loves them, who will never fail to love them, who will always be there for them, and will never drop them. And that God can also change us from within. Father, search our hearts, God, and renew a right spirit in us as we trust in you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Alrighty, kids. Now you can strike up that song, Mr. Chris. Mrs. Brown's laugh.
Try to love one another right now.
This one's for Wendy. Wendy Sue, who is no more than two. That's kind of raucous.
He will be there. Just call on his name. He's always there. Prayer up on the cross.
On the cross,
he took all the pain away. Why can't you see that his power is real? What will it take to open your eyes? You can't deny.
I can't deny
what happened to me in my life.
Song we wrote for our band called Redeemed several years ago. To write a bunch of new song and kick up the music level in the Christian world, and I think that one does it pretty good. Have a great Sunday. God bless you. Remember, therapy's next Saturday at the Farmer's Market, 8:30 to noon, and we'll be back here Sunday at 9 for church again, right here at Causeway Cove Marina.